Hello everyone. The topic for today's discussion is learning-centered approach. Let us look at these three words called as which are learning-centered and approach. Let us try to understand that what is going to unfold in this session. If we look at the meaning of centered, we mean that it is the focus point, and therefore what becomes the focus point for us is learning. And so therefore let's look at what are the focus of this approach. The focus of this approach is that in a teaching learning situation, what students bring to the educational experience. Now, before I go into teaching learning situation, let us look at who are the persons involved in this whole situation, or who are the stakeholders. So, in the teaching learning situation, of course, students are number one the stakeholders, but also now becomes the equal stakeholders are teachers and also the co-learners. So, we have three people involved in this learning-centered approach, which are students, teachers and the co-learners. So, in this teaching learning situation, the first thing that we are going to focus is what students bring to the educational experience. Now, when I say what students bring to the educational experience, it is not only we mean that the student himself or herself is coming to the class, but also the context of the student, the understanding of student, the knowledge of students that the student brings in the classroom. And similarly, the second point of focus is what the teacher is bringing to the educational experience. So, when a teacher is there in a classroom, it is again the teacher's understanding, teacher's knowledge, teacher's context, and also her own educational experience that she brings or he brings to the classroom. The third point to focus here is that how the subject matter or the discipline affects the educational process. So, therefore, another thread that continues between three stakeholders, that is student, teacher and the co-learners, is the subject matter or the discipline. So, what is the discipline structure like that will also guide how this learning-centered approach unfolds. And the fourth point, that is that how the context or the external factors influence the nature of instruction. In the first two points, when I was talking about that what students and the teacher brings to the educational experience, and we said that context is important, so therefore we are now reiterating that point, that it's the context and the external factors are also equally influencing the nature of learning and the nature of instructions that are going to create this learner-centered classroom. So, let us look at how this learning-centered approach, the focus of this learning-centered approach. Now, therefore, since I am saying it is this approach, so therefore, the first and the foremost focus is on the learning process. And when I say the learning process, it is not only the learning processes that is of the students, but also of all the people involved in this classroom. So, therefore, when I say the focus is on learning process, immediately the concern becomes the learning of students. But that doesn't mean that we leave out teachers, and therefore, in this kind of approach, teachers are the one who become co-learners. And this kind of approach places students at the center of the education. So, therefore, we are concerned with the learning processes and the learnings of the student, and immediately when they become the center point of the education, the whole instructions, how the classroom is structured changes. Let us look at an example here. Like for example, we need a student needs to understand a process of how a factory or a working in the factory operates. Now, there are multiple ways of understanding this. We can read it in our books, but suppose if a educational trip is planned for students to be taken out to the factory, then the whole process, the student is able to witness the process right from the starting point to what are the machines that are involved, the functioning of the machines, then what are the processes that are involved, and therefore it becomes an experiential learning, it becomes a hands-on learning that the student is experienced, and not only student but also the teacher, that that is experiencing the same. So the kind of discussions that, or the kind of feedback, or the kind of experiences that are then brought into the classroom become very different. So in that process, there will be more, this kind of approach then becomes a learning-centered approach, because the focus then comes back to learning and how that learning is transacted in a classroom. And therefore, the understanding of the educational context of students become very important, because until and unless we know what this child is bringing to the classroom, we will not be able to plan our instructions, or we are not able to give that kind of enriching classroom experience to the child. Here then brings me to another very important focus of this approach, is the role of teacher. And here the teacher is more of a facilitator. When I say facilitator, implies that a teacher is a person who is creating learning situations, and therefore her or his role becomes more of a mediator, of a guide, who is going to give various inputs to students at various points, so that the focus on learning remains the prime focus. The last focus of this approach is that it seems to be very individualistic approach, yet it is very flexible. It is towards moving towards competency based, and it also, the focus is varied methodology. So no one methodology is followed, and it should be therefore a combination of various methodologies that are there. Now, the another focus is that it helps students acquire competency in skill areas, and then it creates lifelong learners. Example that I shared, it is much beyond what a child reads in a textbook. It goes much beyond, because there the child is witnessing the whole process of working of a machine. It is witnessing the process of how the different components in a factory work. And it is not only the working of machine that the child focuses on. The student also focuses on the how that whole factory is organized. What are the systems that are working into the establishment of a factory. So therefore, it becomes much more enriched, and then the learning is a lifelong learning for the learners. So the another focus of this learning-centered approach is that student acquire basic skills to learn, and thus leads to basis for learning throughout life. Another focus is that it advocates student-focused teaching and learning environment. So when I say that it is a learning-centered approach, when I'm saying that the focus of this approach is on the learning, so therefore immediately then it becomes very focused on the student and the learning, and therefore it becomes very important to understand what are the needs and characteristics of children at every stage of learning, because that will also help the teacher to facilitate this learning oriented process. The another focus that is there, that the learning centered approach facilitates the explanation of meaning and content knowledge through personal and interpersonal inquiry. And I say that this is a very important aspect of this approach, because it is through one's own personal experience. And when we also talked about co-learners, so therefore it is also the interpersonal inquiry that establishes the focus on learning. And so there will be more of sharing that should be there, the more of asking questions among each other. The focus will also be exploring the answers to these questions together. So there should be, it immediately brings the focus to collaborative learning. So these are the various focus points of these approach. Let us look at some examples of this learning-centered approach. The example examples of this learning-centered approach is, like I was mentioning in the last point, that collaborative group learning both inside and outside the classroom is one of the very important aspect then becomes for this approach. And the moment I say collaborative group learning, and it immediately implies that the learning is not happening as an individual process or this individual understanding, though that component is there, but it also gives, this approach gives spaces to collaborate, to do group work, to ask questions, and therefore when I'm saying collaboration, it doesn't limit to the four walls of classroom, it goes beyond the classroom, and that is one of the example. Another is that it involves individual student inquiry and discovery. So, whatever experiences that the teacher is facilitating in the classroom, it will help the individual student to, actually it will set the individual student on a path of exploration. And therefore, exploration resulting in a discovery and resulting in the resultant understanding that develops over a period of time. It also involves inquiry and discovery by students and teachers together. See, the moment I say it's a learning-centered approach and I have already established that the student or the learners are the center of this approach, so it immediately brings in that the partnership or the collaboration can also be between a student and teacher, because we have already said that the focus is also the teachers being co-learners. So therefore, examples can be the inquiry and discovery by a student and teacher together. Another example through which this learning-centered approach can be processed in a classroom is through problem-based inquiry. Problem-based inquiry learning. And when I say a problem-based inquiry means that looking at any sort of a task that is there at hand, which takes on or result in certain kind of questions in the mind of learners, and sets the learner to the path of inquiry and discovery. It also talks about the interactive distance learning. Another way in which learning-centered approach can be executed in classroom is through hands-on experiential learning activities. And when I say hands-on experiential learning activities, it will immediately involve the on-site field experiences. So therefore, suppose we are talking about any sort of concept, you can take any example, like we talk about, like I talked about factory, but it is not only factory. Like for example, if in class students are talking about understanding the structures of plants, so then we can take the children or the learners directly to the field where they can see, they can feel, they can understand what are the various structures and parts of plants. So therefore, on-site field experiences become a very integral part. And the importance also lies is that it is a self-paced performance on contextual tasks. So these are very important words that we are kind of discussing today, is that it is a self-paced. So therefore, the pace of the understanding or the pace of finishing a task is not set by a teacher, but it is set by the individual himself or herself. So therefore, it becomes, and also we already talked about placing it in the context of the teacher and the child or the learner. So therefore, the importance immediately comes to a self-paced performance on contextual task. Let us look at what are the characteristics of this learning-centered approach. The first and the foremost characteristic that I'm going to talk today is that it is a student's construct knowledge through gathering and synthesizing information. Now, when I say that the center or the focus is learning, and we have already established that when we talk about learning, then student becomes the prime focus. Then it is the student construction of his or her own knowledge that becomes of prime importance. And the first characteristics will be how the students gather and synthesize information. And therefore, the focus here becomes not only collecting, but also kind of integrating it, accommodating that understanding, adapting the existing knowledge structures to the new information, and coming to a state of equilibration where you are coming up with a synthesized information. And therefore, it also involves the integration with the skills of inquiry, communication, critical thinking, and problem solving. So, whenever we talk about synthesis or we talk about synthesizing information, there has to be elements of inquiry as to find out what are the questions that it brings in the mind of a learner. Then it also talks about communicating those questions or those understanding to each other, because we have already established the interpersonal processes that should be there. Then it also involves critical thinking and also problem solving, where you focus or locate the a task in hand, and you generate ideas, you generate alternative understandings or alternative frameworks, then you do analysis, and then you come out to the possible resultant understanding or solution of that problem. Another characteristic is that it emphasizes on using communication knowledge effectively. And also the role of teacher here is that of a facilitator, which we have already established. So therefore, the teachers and students evaluate learning together. When we say that it is a learning-centered approach, and when we say that the teachers and students are learning together, and we have already talked about the role of teacher as a facilitator. So, therefore, the component of assessment also becomes very crucial here. And does the assessment is not centered with the teacher, but it becomes a evolving process. It becomes a process where both teacher and student are together involved in the process of evaluation. And therefore, the teaching and assessing becomes interwoven, because the student and the teacher, as much as they are part of the learning process, they are also part of the assessment process. For example, the student can himself or herself come up with the way he wants to assess a particular task. And using communication skills, he or she can discuss those parameters with the teacher, and then the teacher can facilitate or guide further these assessment parameters or evaluation parameters. So therefore, every aspect in a classroom, it becomes a together process, it becomes a collaborative process. It doesn't remain, the focus is not on one individual person. And here also, then the nature of assessment changes. The assessment is not, it also promotes and diagnose learning. It is not only to assess the levels of learning of a student, it also kind of promotes the learning. It also kind of leads you to the areas that are required to be focused in a particular learning situation. Another characteristic feature is that the emphasis is on generating better questions and learning from the errors. So, very interestingly, in a learning process, errors are something that becomes very area of concern for teachers and students, because the moment you are making an error, it kind of taken as an indication that there is somewhere that a student has not understood the concept well. Okay, so it becomes a parameter for assessment. But here we are saying that the teachers and students are creating partners in the assessment process. So therefore, the emphasis is on generating better questions and also learning from errors. So you learn from all the errors that a student is making and take cues from those errors, and therefore the teacher can design the classroom structures or the learning processes such that those focus and take the cues or the hints from those errors. Another aspect, characteristics of a learning-centered approach, is that the desired learning is assessed through various ways, and this is very important. This approach do not focus on only one way of assessment. It focuses on the multiple ways of assessment, because here the learner has also the say in the assessment process. Here the focus is also the context of learning for student as well as a teacher. So therefore, the desired learning is assessed in multiple ways and not in one ways. The learning-centered approach is compatible with interdisciplinary investigation, which is very important, because there are certain areas which requires going beyond your own discipline and stepping into another discipline. For example, let's take our example of visit to the factory. Now, when I am looking at the area of when we visit a factory, we have the whole management discipline where we are looking at how the factories organize, function and everything. Then we also can look into the aspect of the machinery that works. So we are moving into another discipline. Then there might be certain material that is involved in the production. So we are in getting into the domain of the characteristics of those materials. So one experience can lead to the various interdisciplinary investigations. There has to be the characteristic of a learning-centered approach is that the culture of the classroom has to be cooperative and supportive, because when we talk about collaborative learning, then cooperation becomes very important aspect, and when we talk about facilitating, then support given to the student is very important. And it is also not only the support given by the teacher to the student, but also between student and student. So there is a whole atmosphere of cooperation and supportiveness. Then in another characteristic is that here the teacher and the student learn together, which we have already established and elaborated multiple times. Now let us look at the five practices for learning-centered approach. Here we have to look at that the five practices are the functions of content, the role of teacher, responsibility for learning, the balance of power, and processes and purposes of evaluation. In the next section, we are going to take up each practice and discuss in detail. So the first practice that we are going to discuss is the functions of content. In this practice, it is using inquiry or ways of thinking in discipline. It is focusing that the focus. When we talk about content, then it is very important for students to learn to solve real problems, because it also will give them connect to the context that they are bringing into the classroom. It also understands the function of the content and why it is learned. Many times students wonder that why are we learning this particular area, or why am I studying or reading about this aspect. So therefore, here it will become the focus is then to understand the function of the content and to understand the importance of that content. It builds the content or there is a discipline specific learning methodologies. So we talk about interdisciplinary approaches, but we also focus that the content is built on the discipline specific learning methodologies, and thus there is a build of that content. Then there is the focus is also on the appreciation for the value of content. And it also helps students develop a way to learn through the context and make meaning out of the context as well. It brings me down to the second practice, which is the role of teacher. And we have already established here that the role of teacher is that of a facilitator. And therefore, the moment I say that the teacher as a facilitator, so it brings to the first aspect, that is that the teacher is fostering students' learning. And also the teacher is accommodating different learning styles and also motivates students to accept responsibility for the learning. So therefore there are three things that we are talking about. Here the teacher is fostering the learning processes in the student, and the moment the teacher is doing that, it is also going to motivate students to accept responsibility of learning, because here the teacher doesn't have the role of constructing the kind of environment in the classroom where the, if I can say, the power is with the teacher. So therefore, the teacher all the more needs to motivate students to take up that responsibility that yes, it's a process where I am at the focus. And for that as well, the teacher has to use multiple learning styles. It cannot be one learning style, because it will create an atmosphere of, it will take away the monotony in the classroom, as well as it will then encourage and motivate the students toward the path of exploration and discovery. The role of teacher here will be to align the objectives, teaching methods and assessment consistently. So therefore, the whole aspect of why am I studying here will go away, or why am I studying this particular area will go away, because the teacher is kind of focusing on the objectives, teaching methods and assessment consistently. The teacher is also going to use multiple teaching techniques appropriate for student learning goals. So the goals that are set for the learning process for a particular student or a classroom, then the teacher has to focus on the various different techniques that can be used for a particular area that will also be related to their learning goals and that are very contextual in nature. The teacher needs to also design activities in which students interact with the material, the teacher, and with each other. So therefore, the learning techniques, first priority, and then the second is the activities. And the teachers need to inspire and encourage student ownership of the learning. The third important practice is the responsibility of learning. And it is very important here, because the moment the responsibility comes to one partner of the learning process, be it teacher or be it the student, then the whole idea of collaboration goes away, because then it will be either guided by the teacher or either guided by the student, and somewhere the learning process will get affected. And therefore, the very beauty of this approach is that here there is a shared responsibility of learning between the teacher and the child. And the moment it becomes a shared responsibility, then the expectation that students take overall responsibility of the learning and assessment, and or the teacher takes the overall responsibility of learning and assessment, then goes away, and it becomes immediately a collaborative process. So therefore, as a result, students develop learning skills for further learning. They become self-directed lifelong learners. They can and do assess their own learning. They become proficient at self-assessment, and they become proficient with all information literacy skills. So you can see that the moment the responsibility of the learning becomes shared, it just changes the atmosphere of the classroom and it just changes the focus area of the whole learning process. We have the components of self-assessment, then we have the component of self-directed learning and bringing in the concept of exploration, discovery. Also, very important concept here that this approach brings out is the self-assessment. So, the student doesn't have to depend on being assessed through an external person. Here, the assessment is also from within. And that also kind of sets them to the path of further exploration and motivates them to the further path of learning. The fourth practice is the processes and purposes of evaluation. Here, the evaluation is more of an integrated assessment, where the formative assessment is with constructive feedback. Now, this is very important because feedback can be very problematic or troublesome for the learners. So, therefore, and when the moment I say the approach is centering on or the focusing on the learning, the feedback has to be in constructive. The feedback needs to take you forward to or question you or assess your own self and therefore making the learner more intuitive. It has to be peer and self-assessment. There has to be multiple opportunities to learn and demonstrate mastery. Students encouraged to justify their answers, and student and teachers agree on feedback time frames. There has to be an authentic assessment is used throughout. The last practice is the balance of power. Students has more control over their own learning. The teacher needs to make deliberate efforts to empower the students to assume control over their learning. Students are encouraged to explore additional content. Students are encouraged to express alternative perspectives whenever appropriate. Use of mastery or contract grading assessments are open-ended. Assignments are open-ended and students take advantage of opportunities to learn. So, therefore, in order to sum up this table, let's just quickly sum up what are the aspects of learning-centered approach and how they are there in this approach. So, the nature of knowledge in this approach is knowledge is constructed by the learner. And the role of teacher and learner is that the learner acts and teacher facilitating learning. Dominant teacher functions as the facilitating learning supporting. The situation in learning-centered approach is that of a natural and contextual to learning. Control is dominantly learner controlled, which is more flexible and democratic. The inputs here will be through techniques and strategies of learning. The methods and approach are activity based and scaffolding. Curriculum is emergent. Evaluation is authentic assessment and self-analytical, and the discipline is self-controlled. I summarize the learning-centered approach. Thank you, everyone.